Alright, so now let's talk a bit about debugging. So, the basic solution to debugging, which probably everybody has been using at some point in their programming life and continues to use, is to just use something like printf or println and all related methods to output textual debug information on the terminal. Of course, this is a very simple approach and also a very simplistic approach. The biggest drawback maybe is that it's not flexible, because if you want to modify whatever debug output your program is producing, you will have to recompile it, because you will have to modify your print statements and recompile your program and then run it again. Also, you usually have to keep track in your head of where the program actually is right now and what's happening inside there. Maybe you're also outputting some variable values, but you have to always keep a model of what the program does right now in your head based on what you're seeing on the terminal. So this can actually be quite mentally demanding. If you have printf, println statements inside some sort of inner loop, then you can get a massive amount of text output, which then can also slow your program down. And often it's simply too much to parse manually. So by just reading the output, this is simply not possible anymore. Of course, this approach also has its advantages. It basically works everywhere, so you don't need any special kind of program for that. You just can execute your binary and still get the debug output. Maybe if you have to deploy it on some kind of remote platform, then that's actually a good thing. And of course, it's very straightforward. You just write in a statement where you suspect something unexpected is happening, and then check if that's actually the case. But there's a lot more advanced way to actually debug your program, and this is the so-called debugger. This is a specific piece of software which has three main features, basically. It allows you to stop your program at an arbitrary point that you can define upfront. So you can say, whenever it enters method XYZ, then I want the program to stop, to be halted. Then, when the program has been halted, you can step through each line of program code individually and also resume the regular execution. But you can execute each command separately and stop the program immediately afterwards again. And this is especially helpful in combination with the inspection feature, which allows you to actually have a live view of variables and objects and their contents. And every time you execute one line of code, then you can also immediately see how that influences the variables in your code and how the values change and so on. So these are the three really important features which basically every debugger has. And now I'd like to go through the commands that basically every debugger offers. It's important to keep in mind that how the commands are actually called is kind of different between what the debugger you use, no matter if it's GDB or Java Debugger, if it's Eclipse, Visual Studio, it doesn't really matter. So the names are maybe sometimes slightly different, but the functionality is always the same. And so the first command just about every debugger has in common to set a so-called breakpoint. That means that when a specific method is called or a specific line in the code is reached, then the program will be halted, and you can then interactively examine the variables and step through each line of code. Then there's also the concept of a watch point. This is very similar to the breakpoint, but now that means that the program is stopped whenever a specific variable is changed. So whenever somebody writes to that value, then the program will halt. And depending on what problem you're trying to debug, each of them can have value. It kind of depends on the context, of course. Other important programs for basically all debuggers are the step function to execute the next line of code. And this usually is split into two versions, two sub-functions. One is usually called step into. That means that when you execute a line of code that contains another function call, then you will continue to step through the lines of code inside that called function. On the other hand, if you execute something called step over often, then the function that you're calling the subfunction will be executed in total, and the execution will stop again after that method call on the next line of code. So you can decide between either stepping into each and every subfunction too, or just skipping them basically and executing them as one unit. This is probably the most important feature that all debuggers basically should have, in combination with breakpoints, of course. Then what's also very important is to have this inspector or a variable watch that just gives you a live view of the value of specific variables in your code, especially while you're stepping through the code, because then you immediately see how a specific function, a specific command influences the state of your program and changes the variables. And last but not least, when you are at a point where you don't want to step through thousands of lines of code, then you can just execute a run, or sometimes also called continue, command. That means that the program will resume normal execution until it hits the next breakpoint or watch point, and then you can again use step and its variants to go through the code one by one. All right, so if you want to productively use a debugger, then you also need to be familiar with the idea behind stack frames. We already learned last time that the stack is part of the main memory for each program or each thread. And this is a dedicated part which keeps track of what functions you called and what and also uses part of the stack for the storage space for the local variables of these functions. Stack usually grows downward. This isn't such a big issue in Java. In C, it's more important because that means that it might at some point collide with the heap. But nevertheless, this is sometimes helpful to keep in mind. And in terms of debugging, what's important now is that there's the concept of a stack frame. That means one part of the memory on the stack, which contains the local variables and also the return address. We come to that in a moment, of the function that's currently active. And when you're using a debugger, then you also usually have a command that lets you go up and down through this stack to earlier call frames and look at the variables that are, for example, used there. So what the caller for the current function kind of is providing as context. And the list of all these stack frames is the current call stack. So this is the path of execution. Basically, the program has taken up to a specific point by calling various methods. And I'll show you an example right now to illustrate this a little further. So let's say we have a really simple program that consists of three functions. And so main is calling function one. Function one is calling function two, and then it's going back to function one, to main, and exiting. And let's say we are using a debugger and have stopped the program in line two, then the stack frame for the main method won't contain much. It gets more interesting if we continue, for example, through function one into line seven, for example. Then we have two things on that stack frame. One is the return address. This basically tells the program where it should continue after this this function has finished, which is returning to the next line after the function call in main. And it also contains the memory storage for the local variables, in this case, this integer I. And something very similar will happen when we execute then the next function, function 2. So let's say we're now in line 12. Now we also have a return address, which is now going back to line 9 in function 1, of course. And we also have storage both for the local variable and for the parameter that the function gets passed. So and when function 2 terminates, basically, then it will return to line 9 and will remove that frame from the stack again. When function 1 terminates, it will return to main and will return this frame, and then we're back at the start, and the main function will exit and the program will terminate. All right, so this was the idea behind stack frames, and this is also something you will encounter when you're using a debugger. One additional thing to keep in mind when using a debugger in general is that by default, the debugger is a separate program that doesn't know the function names, variables, and so on. It can only basically show you memory addresses. And if you want to know basically which variable has which name actually, which is of course extremely helpful, then you must somehow tell the compiler to put those names into the executable or into the class file actually. Most compilers, both for G and for Java, use the minus G flag for that. A big drawback, of course, is that when you do that, the resulting binary is first of all larger, because it does contain additional information that's not necessary for actually running the program, and sometimes it can also slow down. So usually if you have a release build that you actually want to publish somewhere, then this is without debugging information, also because this debugging information can actually reveal internal information about your program that you maybe don't want everybody else to know. All right.